Welcome back to Analog IAS current affair analysis for 21st of May 2021. In this video, we'll be looking at this couple of issues. The outdated nature of bureaucracy. This article is with respect to the second wave of COVID and how it has exposed the inherent weaknesses of our bureaucracy. So bureaucracy's major role is to ensure service delivery. This role has taken a hit in this pandemic, and this article is trying to highlight the necessity of reforms in the way bureaucracy can function in our country for better results. Let us have a look at the points that are discussed in this article. Firstly, we have to understand what is the composition or what is the feature of the traditional view of bureaucracy. When we talk about the traditional view of bureaucracy, we are referring to the public administrative thinker Weber. So this Weberian democratic model has Weberian bureaucracy. This Weberian bureaucracy says that we have to create a working force which is predominantly generalist and very flexible. So we want generalist more than specialist. So this is the broad idea. So this is how our Indian administrative service is structured. So the second component of this traditional view is that there is a preference to the leadership of position. In the present scheme of things, it so happens that those who are aware of the ground reality, who has expert knowledge, they are not in the leadership driven roles. Because of the structure existing in our country, we have secretaries of respective ministries reaching out to the specialists or experts to understand the next steps that are to be taken. So this brings us to the point that we have to encourage even the leadership of function. So there are two kinds of leadership. One is leadership of position and the other one is leadership of function. So in this leadership of function, a person who has the expert knowledge of a particular task will be dealing with that situation rather than helping out the person who held this position historically. So in this, the role of the leader, as in the functional role, is that we have to ensure that this person is given the authority not to issue orders but to explain. So the component that we are focusing here is team building. We have to work together as a team. Imagine the situation in COVID. No single person can dictate orders and expect every kind of official below him to follow the same orders and get results, because the person who is giving out these orders may not always be aware of the data and conditions on the ground reality from time to time. So the person who is actually in a much better position to trust his team, explain the situation and delegate the authority will be handling this situation much better. Second aspect is that of innovation after leadership. When we're talking about innovation, there is absolutely lack of any innovation. It is very rigid. We just stick to the rules. And this has resulted in the rejection of innovation completely. We have to understand that innovation should always have a higher preference over rules, because ultimately rules are created for efficiency. And if efficiency is stopped because we are following rules, then something is definitely wrong with the rules, or the time of that rule has eventually passed away. So we have to focus on innovation. So these are the two points that you have to remember. One is the traditional view that holds generalists at a higher pedestal than a specialist, and the kinds of leadership, the reason why innovation is not encouraged in our bureaucracy. So these are the points that we have to understand, the ground reality. Now, how did COVID expose this limitations of the traditional bureaucratic model? Let us examine. The most prominent trend that we have seen is that healthcare professionals should be ideally taking all the decisions to handle a pandemic rather than an IAS officer. The argument is that IAS officers are in a better position to understand the ground realities and therefore they should handle the situation. But considering the fact that healthcare professionals are equally adaptable to the situation, since this is a unprecedented crisis, it is much more easier for healthcare professionals to understand the ground reality rather than IAS officers is the argument. So the justification that generalist provides a broader perspective has completely failed in the present scenario. And as an alternative, what is being suggested is that privatization. Can privatization actually solve the problems of the present bureaucratic structure? Is privatization and private sector managerial techniques an answer for the present system? In order to answer this, we have to understand a practice called new public management system. Generally, this is very prominent in PubMed students, but you have to understand that this is being discussed from GS perspective. So what do you mean by this new public management system? Basically, we bring the best practices from private sector and apply those principles in government bureaucracy. So the objective is improving public service delivery and governance. Now the question is this option viable in our present conditions? In order to apply this, you should not compare the private sector with that of government. Why? There are some variables that we have to understand when we are applying it to a society and not a company or a corporate world. In a society, especially in a society like India, one, we have social inequality. That is, we still have a significant chunk of population that did not have the kind of access to education and probably advantages like internet services as urban people have. There are completely detached rural locations even in the 21st century India as well. Secondly, we are talking about regional variations. So this regional inequality will be augmented. Say for example, if we don't apply similar rules considering even the regional inequalities, let us take an advanced state like which is a relatively wealthier state, say X, some South Indian state which has much technocratic power, like say Bangalore based Karnataka or Hyderabad based Telangana. They have a head start in this practice. There will be inequality within the state as well as regionally as well. When you compare it with a state like Uttar Pradesh or Bihar, where there is a resource crunch, you cannot apply one rule for Telangana and Karnataka and another rule for Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. It should be similar because we are living in the same country. So that is the problem when we try to adapt this new public management principles. But does that again mean that we don't have any other solution? No, we do have a solution, and that solution is called collaborative governance. Let us understand what that is. So when we're talking about collaborative governance, in our GS2 syllabus, we have something called civil society. What is this civil society? We are basically talking about non-governmental organizations or organizations into social entrepreneurship, which reduce this social inequality and regional inequality. So this concept of social welfare is the basis for functioning of this civil society, which are working towards the rights of citizens. Till now, what happened is government and bureaucracy has been looking at civil society as an agent that is trying to take away its sphere of influence and power. Instead of looking at this civil society as an antagonistic force, what the new model of bureaucracy should adapt is work in tandem with the civil society, or use the civil society to deliver services. Now, just to quote an example, in South India, especially in Hyderabad, Akshay Patra Foundation is offering meal at 5 rupees to the poor public. This is possible because of a collaborative government approach or collaborative governance model, wherein the capacities of these civil societies, which are specialists in their own way, is actually used by the government to deliver service. And in this case, we're talking about nutritional security. Similar practices can be seen in almost every walk of life and every service delivery we can witness. Say for example, if we have to understand the reality of ground level educational quality, we have had Pradham survey, which comes out with annual survey of education report, which helps us understand the ground reality. So collecting data can be easier if we use and empower the organizations like this. So it goes hand in hand with the aspirations of the civil society and also the objective of the government to give services. So this model should be seriously considered, and without this we cannot create a new revolution sort of a thing. So in this context, the author gives example of Green Revolution as to how it has collaborated with M.S. Swaminathan, a famous scientist, to change the face of Indian agriculture. There are many such examples. Even we can consider the IT revolution, where Sam Pitroda has been instrumental in creating that IT policy for our country, which saw the growth of IT giants in our country. We are talking about companies like Infosys, TCS, all those became possible because of private company organizations, which encouraged the government initiatives or supplemented the government initiatives. We should stop looking at civil society as a roadblock in our implementation of policies. Rather, the bureaucracy should restructure itself to work in tandem with civil society. That is the gist of this article. The article titled "An Issue of Lives versus Livelihoods" is about the plight of migrant workers in the pandemic. If you take a look at our economy, almost 90% of the workers are in unorganized sector or informal sector. So what do you understand by this? What do you infer from this fact? It means that there is no social security whatsoever. What happens if there is no social security? Imagine the situation of these workers when a lockdown is imposed. What kind of economic plight they might be facing in these times, it is unimaginable. Therefore, whenever there is a question of lockdown, what the government is thinking is, this is a choice between lives, that is saving lives in the pandemic, versus livelihoods. So we are in a peculiar situation where either of the choices will lead to unimaginable pain. What should the government do taking this forward? That is the central debate in this article. On one hand, we have the COVID-19 hitting India like a tsunami. The health infrastructure is crumbling under its own weight. The country is once again staring at the issue of this lives and livelihoods like it has faced the last year when there was a nationwide lockdown imposed on March 24th, 2020. In addressing this question, we have to fundamentally ask three questions to design a policy that is foolproof. Firstly, we have to understand where this migrant workers are and where are they going to. So mostly it is the Bimaru states or the erstwhile states which were considered to be extremely poor, and they continue to bear the brunt of this economic plight. Say for example, we have migrants coming all the way from Bihar in states like Kerala, Karnataka, and sometimes even in states like Tamil Nadu, all the southern states. The reason is there is lack of opportunity in their home states. So the question we have to ask is, what are the employment opportunities for them at their native places? And the next question is, what should be the role of government? How can the government help them? Last year, when the government was faced with the same question, they came up with the answer in the form of enhanced allocations to the MNREGA, which is nothing but the right to work, which ensures 100 days of employment for skilled and unskilled workers also. So is this a sort of a gainful employment in this time? Is this what the government can do? That is the question. Some surveys have actually conducted surveys to understand the plight of these workers who came back from cities. Say a worker from a place like Mumbai traveled back to his native place in Bihar. He was making around 15,000 rupees a month in a place like Mumbai. But after he went back to his native place, the amount reduced to a paltry 2,000 rupees. Even considering the cost of living in places like Mumbai, this is a very, very significant reduction in income.
and they simply cannot sustain themselves with this kind of small incomes. Another question that we have to ask is, looking at the data from last year, can we say that Manrega has actually helped the migrant population? So the answer is no, because if you take a look at the data, the increase in demand for Manrega works is just 5% in phase 1, and in phase 2 it is somewhere around 7.5%. This is simply not enough to meet the demand of the people who are coming back to these places. Another survey said that only 1.75% of the migrants who came back had this Jandan accounts. So that means even their financial inclusion aspect is under threat, because all the government schemes are linked to bank accounts and Aadhaar now. That is another challenge that we have to understand. So all this shows that existing government programs cannot provide gainful employment opportunities to the migrants at their native place. This is the ground reality. It is already overcrowded. Engaging the returning migrants in building new agri-value chains has certain potential to create productive employment. That is also what was discussed the other day, almost last week, in Indian Express by Dr. Ashok Gulati as well. So that is a very important suggestion, because if we take a look at the employment structure in rural areas, it is mostly dependent on rural agrarian economy. So if we have to create any value addition, it should definitely be coming from food processing, and value addition in agriculture are one area where Dr. Ashok Gulati believes that it can add value. Anyway, coming back to the topic, this also brings to the notice one glaring issue of lack of social security for informal sector. So one more lesson that we can learn from this experience is that the government must force employers to ensure that the workers in informal sector have at least some level of social security. Also, this is not just a question of social security and welfare. It is a question of morals, because these workers contributed to the city economy. But what has the city given them in return when the time has come? This is the question we have to ask from an ethical perspective. Is it right to consider them just as resource in our economic development model, but not as human beings, is the question that is being asked. Can we justify the situation as a step to save lives, but at the same time, we are also putting them not just under the burden of carrying an infection, but also we are also putting them under a threat of lack of livelihoods. That is what this article is trying to say. So the focus should be on social security going forward. At the same time, you also have to ensure gainful employment at grassroots levels. So that is the gist of this article.